Welcome to the Stanford Geriatric Education Center webinar series on dementia evaluation and management of diverse older adults and their families. This program is co-sponsored with AGS, California AHEC, and Community Health Partnerships. I am Elaine McBride, Associate Director Emeriti at Stanford GEC and coordinator of the Preparedness Program. Three webinars are provided by the Geriatric Emergency Preparedness and Response Collaborative on aspects of emergency preparedness for older adults, including those with dementia. Our session is about a state model, the CCOPER program, or the Continuing of Care Operational Preparedness and Emergency Response Program. Judy Metcalf and Kathy Knight are highly effective collaborators who provide leadership and expertise to the success of the CCOPER program. A live interactive session with Judy and Kathy is scheduled. As you go through the content, write your questions, then type them in the chat box during the live session. We are required to disclose that we do not have financial interest in products or materials used for this training. Today, we'll learn about the CCOPER program, strategies used to coordinate and support planning efforts, and lessons learned from this state model. The next slides are background information on the presenters. I'll briefly introduce them, and you can return to the slides for more information. Judy Metcalf is the director of the University of New England, Maine GEC. Kathy Knight is the director of the Northeastern Maine Regional Resource Center at Eastern Maine Medical Center. This next slide, I'll skip. And the collaborative consists of six HRSA-funded GECs. They received supplemental funds in 2004 to initiate geriatric preparedness training, and HRSA funds were released in response to the statement on the urgent need for aging and preparedness training of health providers developed by the National Association of GECs. It was presented to HRSA after the September 11 airplane crashes and the devastation of three successive hurricanes, the worst of which was Katrina. On March 30, 2011, the White House released a directive to develop a national goal for preparedness, core capabilities, and a national system for preparedness to guide programs towards the national goal. Craig Fugate, administrator, reaffirmed FEMA's responsibility to serve disaster survivors. However, he underscored partnership with communities to be an essential component of emergency management. With these policy statements, the whole community concept was introduced into the national dialogue on preparedness and resiliency. A FEMA publication explains whole community as a team approach to understand and assess needs and actions that strengthen the capacity of communities to cope and record in a shorter period of time. FEMA noted that education for cultural competency of emergency management staff is critical to building relationships and teams at the community level to improve resiliency in diverse populations. The collaborative continues to offer preparedness trainings in various ways. One approach is the formation by three collaborative members of a national consortium to provide 12 preparedness webinars over 5 years. The UNA Maine GEC organized the sixth of the 12 webinars. Now, Judith Metcalf will talk about the academic community partnerships that contributed to the development and sustainability of the CCOPER program. Thank you. And here's Judy.
Thank you, Milen. As Malen stated, the University of New England Maine Geriatric Education Center is pleased to be part of the National Association of Geriatric Education Centers Initiative Geriatric Emergency Preparedness Response Collaborative since 2010. The UNE Maine GEC has been fortunate to be able to collaborate with Kathy Knight, Director of the Northeastern Maine Regional Resource Center at Eastern Maine Medical Center, the EMHS Center for Emergency Preparedness, and others at Eastern Maine Healthcare Systems. This collaboration has created the opportunity for a robust academic community partnership, as well as being able to leverage both grants, tap into areas of emergency preparedness expertise, and provide resources and emergency preparedness and response training to Maine's health professionals. Kathy Knight will present the Continuum of Care, Operational Preparedness and Emergency Response Grant-Funded Program, CCOPER, as a model used in Maine to provide emergency preparedness training and education.
I'd like to provide an overview of the CCOPER grant to start us off. So first, we're going to be looking at a background behind all the information behind the CCOPER grant and how it got started. Additionally, we'll be looking at the purpose of the CCOPER grant, the scope, who the partners were, the structure for the CCOPER grant, what the deliverables were, what are some of the challenges and barriers that we encountered, and also strategies for success. We had a little extra money, so purchases were made, and what were those and why we made those purchases. Also, the program evaluation and lessons learned. So if we take it back a few steps, in 2004, Maine CDC worked with EMMC, Eastern Maine Medical Center, to develop one of three regional resource centers. These three regional resource centers were designed and based on trauma referral patterns from 1996. And the reason Maine CDC wanted to work with regional resource centers, meaning hospitals that were trauma centers that could guide the preparedness response planning in each of their regions, was because this was a model that had been used in other states very successfully. And they were receiving funding from originally the Hospital Bioterrorism Program and now the Hospital Preparedness Program. And they wanted to make sure that we worked collaboratively and we standardized the products that were being put out into our communities. So they engaged the regional resource centers. During my work with the regional resource centers and building our healthcare coalition, one of the problems that we observed right around 2009 was that we didn't have the participation that we really needed with long-term care facilities, residential care, assisted living, and home health care agencies. And so, unbeknownst to me, also our Continuum of Care Vice President, Lisa Harvey McPherson at Eastern Maine Healthcare Systems, was also interested in this topic. And we got together and did a brief survey, a very short survey, with our EMHS organizations spanning over just three counties. We surveyed eight long-term care facilities and Eastern Maine Home Care as well. Now, just to give you a little bit background on the eight counties that my regional resource center serves, we have a total population of about 438 people. Nearly 67,000 people in that region are older than 65 years of age. Now, this is higher than the national average of elders in our population. And approximately 54 long-term care facilities originally counted, but when we later added the residential care, some long-term care facilities that we had missed, and we did a strong accounting, that number grew tremendously. Also, we have approximately 15 home health care agencies and 19 hospital service areas, as well as two behavioral health care facilities. And the picture to your left gives you pretty much an overview of the counties that we cover. If there's no writing in those counties, then those belong to one of the other regional resource centers. So we have approximately 66% of the geographic territory of the state of Maine. So when we did this brief survey, what we found is that very few organizations had engaged in all hazards emergency response preparedness planning. Now what does that mean, all hazards? That means that when we're taking a look at all of the different scenarios and events that might happen which would cause damage to the building or affect the organization in some way, in a negative way, then we're looking at all different sorts of hazards. And when we're building our emergency management plan, we have to make sure that we're looking and operating under the auspices of an all-hazards planning structure. Now, very few of our organizations had done all-hazards planning. And part of that is that only 50% of those individuals that were surveyed had actually developed a response plan that was specific for different types of emergencies rather than just a generalized plan. Also, the majority of the emergency response plans were untested. They had never worked on them as part of a workshop or a drill or a full-scale exercise or even a tabletop exercise to see if those plans that they had developed would actually work properly when the time came to put them to use. Approximately 75% of the population that responded to the survey did not have staff training programs for emergency preparedness. Now, this is a particularly concerning finding since some of the regulatory requirements for long-term care facilities do require staff training programs, and they're very, very clear on that. Also, we found that the majority of the emergency preparedness plans were incomplete. Oftentimes, an organization would state in their survey that they had a plan, but then when we went back to investigate a little further and ask a few additional questions, what we found is those organizations did not really have a plan. When we went back to investigate the plans for those organizations, we found that those organizations didn't necessarily have a written plan. They had a plan in place, but it was stuck inside someone's head, and they had not actually put it on paper. So if it's not on paper, you don't have a plan. Even though somebody has worked it out in their head, it's not a plan until it's on paper. At the conclusion of this very brief and informal survey, we identified 5 major planning gaps. Now, these planning gaps are, interestingly enough, very similar or the same as the planning gaps that were identified in a similar program in Florida. The gaps included that there was a huge lack of coordination between local, regional, and state emergency management partners, long-term care services, and home health. Now, home health care and long-term care, residential and assisted living, are organizations that are not traditionally included in emergency response planning. This is a major problem. Without them being closely identified with and working to plan collaboratively, then they're sort of left outside the loop, and they're not going to have their needs met when the time comes to institute a community-based emergency management plan. Also, we found that decision-making criteria and guidelines for resident evacuation were not in place. Most organizations had decided to focus more on sheltering in place. Understandably so. For the most part, it's so much easier to take care of your patients inside the facility rather than to evacuate. And usually that is probably the better option for you, but you still have to have decision-making criteria by which you go to make that decision. So when the time comes, if it's an insidious creep of a type of an event and it slowly creeps up on you, you still have that criteria to lean back on. Otherwise, it may pass you by. You may get to a point where you don't realize that you actually have to make that decision to evacuate. Also, we found that the development of effective communication systems did not happen in most organizations. They did not have backup technology. Their communication systems consisted of their telephones and their facility. Very few facilities had more than one computer, and that usually was in the office of the superintendent. it's a real problem. There was no ham radio collaboration with the amateur radio emergency services in their areas. There was not even a NOAA radio which would help to alert them in the event of a severe weather warning. So that was a major issue. Communication is always the thing that fails in a disaster situation, so we really needed to work on that. We also found that established resident tracking and case management systems were not in place in the event that they did have to evacuate their facility. Now, this has been a problem that has been identified across the country. If you look at Joplin, where Mercy Hospital in Joplin had to evacuate their facility as a result of being hit directly by a tornado. Now, they did a fantastic job. Within 90 minutes, they had evacuated their entire facility. And their concern was the safety of their patient population. They had an unstable facility that truly needed to be emergently evacuated. Patients were piled into passenger cars and other forms of transport, and they were taken to other hospitals in the region. Now, when this organization did their after-action review, they identified that this was a major problem, that although they were very efficient and did a great job in evacuating their facility rapidly and ensuring the safety of their patient population, what happened is they had trouble tracking their patients and where they were taken. And so multiple other hospitals have identified the same problem. You'll see a lot of work being done in the upcoming year on a national level for this problem that we're talking about. It's come to national attention. Also, the development and refining of an all-hazards disaster preparedness plan. And again, this comes as part of exercising and working closely with partners to make sure you get the best possible plan that you can arrange. So following the assessment that we did, that informal assessment, we went back as Eastern Maine Healthcare Systems, and we worked with Susan Collins as well as some other individuals to apply for some grant funding to work on the problem of getting the continuum of care up to date with emergency response and preparedness. So Susan Collins was a great assistance to us. She has been very dedicated to elderly issues here in the United States. She's been very dedicated to homeland security issues as well, and we're very grateful for the support of her office. Lisa Harvey McPherson worked very closely with her to allow us to get this grant opportunity. So what did we want to accomplish with this CCOPER grant, or the Continuum of Care Operational Preparedness and Emergency Response Grant? Well, originally this was intended to be a 3-year project. We had many tasks that needed to be accomplished in that 3-year period, but when the award came back to us, it was for 12 months only. So we were funded for year October 1st, 2010 to September 30th, 2011. And this was a highly compressed timeline, and it was very, very scary in some ways, because a normal plan to develop from scratch is basically a 2 to 4 year program, and we were trying to compress this in 12 months. And so it was concerning at first, but we picked up the challenge. We're also focusing on long-term care facilities, home health care agencies, and hospice agencies originally, and then some of our residential care facilities and assisted living facilities asked to be included as well in the project. So the project also is expanded in scope as well. Our purpose was, one, we wanted to design a detailed regional assessment of the continuum of care readiness. So what is their level of preparedness and how well are they connected? We wanted to get a better idea of what their situation was and whether they were at all working with the traditional preparedness community. We also wanted to develop tools that could be used, out-of-the-box tools that were standardized and just baseline tools that an organization could then use to build their own emergency preparedness program, such as plan templates, exercises, training programs for these targeted organizations. We also wanted to eventually bring the target organizations, which is long-term care, residential, assisted living, and home health care and hospice, into the Northeastern Maine Regional Resource Center, which is Region 3 here in the state of Maine. And that's our healthcare coalition. So this initial work would get them started, and then we would bring them into the larger healthcare coalition for the Northeastern region and continue on the work and ensure that they gradually moved into the traditional emergency preparedness response planning structure that they had been left out of for so many years. We also wanted to develop a planning model that would be capable of readily being duplicated in other rural areas in the Maine as well as nationally. Our scope turned out to be 9 counties, and they're listed here. And the target organizations, again, we expanded the target organizations as previously discussed. Some of the partners that we included were the Maine Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, Maine Emergency Management Agency, Maine Healthcare Association, Maine Primary Care Association, the 2 senators' offices. We wanted to make sure that they could continue to have oversight of the utilization of the funding that we had obtained. We wanted to be very transparent about the usage of funding. The 3 regional resource centers, the other 2 that were not included in the grant, the agencies on aging, the American Red Cross, Maine EMS, public safety, and of course UNE, the Maine Geriatric Education Center, Home Care Alliance of Maine, and EMHS. Now, these organizations were all involved primarily at the steering level committee. This slide would show you other planning partners that you may include in your emergency response planning and collaboration. Both local, state, federal, and private organizations that may assist you in some way. Many of these organizations would be ad hoc members of your committee and your work as an emergency on your emergency preparedness plan. And that's because many of these organizations don't want to take the time to sit through meetings that may not have anything to do with them. So it's really important to pick and choose and plan your agenda to meet the needs of your partners as well so that you're using their time optimally and not wasting it. CCOPER structure was, we had the CDC grant oversight. We had a grant officer that provided guidance from the federal level. We had EMHS executive leadership in the form of Lisa Harvey McPherson. And we had the steering committee, which included the partners that we have already identified. And then the CCOPER collaborative, or healthcare coalition. And that was broken up into 10 sub-regions because of the sheer size of our region. We also had organizations that volunteered to be test organizations. And what does this mean, to be a test organization? Well, these organizations would work closely with the CCOPER team on the products that were being developed. And they would trial these products and troubleshoot them a little bit to ensure that they were optimal, at least initially, before being presented to the larger groups. We had 2 long-term care and 2 home health care / hospice organizations that participated as testing organizations. And we tried to make sure that we had 1 large and 1 small organization to address the gamut of issues that we might have across the board for long-term care and home health. Some of our deliverables included what you see here on the screen. Now, we broke it up into mitigation, preparedness, response, and recovery because these are the four stages or phases of the emergency management cycle. And we wanted our partners to start to learn the terminology that is used by other emergency management personnel. So for mitigation, some of the activities were regional assessment. So some of the activities would include a regional assessment, which we've already talked about the need for in doing that detailed regional assessment. An all hazards HVA, which is a hazard vulnerability analysis. The hazard vulnerability analysis would be an organization would evaluate different hazards or scenarios that might occur and how well prepared they are to deal with those scenarios. And if we use the Kaiser Permanente model, then we would also be evaluating the community's preparedness. Because if the community is not well prepared for a disaster scenario, then they can't provide support and assistance to the organization in their time of need. So we need to know how well prepared the community is as well as how prepared the organization is. So we do this all hazards HVA to identify what our highest risks are so that we can concentrate our planning for the upcoming year on those risks. Also, we wanted to do a 96-hour analysis of operational sustainability. Now, when we do this, we're looking at different utilities, such as the amount of fuel we have for generators, the amount of food we have, and have we made a plan to extend one day's worth of food for 3 days, those type of things. We want to determine how long we can go without community or external assistance. And this is an important analysis, again, so that we can identify what our level of risk is. Then we wanted to also know how many organizations or work on organizational MOUs or Memorandum of Understanding. These are gentlemen's agreements, so to speak, where two organizations would agree on how to share resources in a disaster situation to hopefully increase the likelihood of successful survival throughout the event. Also, we wanted to use some of the funding to purchase equipment, and we knew that that was going to be a little challenging because of the sheer number of organizations that were participating, that money wouldn't spread as far. Under preparedness, we wanted to, of course, develop those all-hazard emergency management plan templates that we could share with our partners and hopefully provide them that standardized foundation for their emergency management plan, and to develop a training program that they could also use. In terms of response, we wanted to get them to understand and to start working on exercise programs that would be HCEAP compliant. HCEAP stands for Homeland Security Exercise Evaluation Program. And this is a national program that provides some guidance on how to develop, conduct, and evaluate your exercises. And if everyone uses this template, then we all have a better chance of having a useful exercise and after-action review. And then finally, recovery. We wanted to provide some information and some standardized plans for demobilization of resources following or during an event. So if we've borrowed staff from another organization or we've borrowed equipment from another organization, if we've moved our patients from the long-term care facility to another austere environment such as a school temporarily, when do we demobilize those resources? When do we send the extra staff home or clean up the equipment and return it to its owner? Those type of things. Also, recovery plan. Recovery is one of those issues that is not well addressed by any organization at this point in time, and we're really concentrating on recovery plans this year. it's important that an organization has a plan on how they get back to business as usual. And that's not as easy as it sounds. It's not simply at the end of an event you go back to business as usual. You may have damage to your facility. You may have lost your market share because people are fearful of sending their loved ones back to your facility. There are many issues that you may have to recover from. And then finally, we wanted to have a good program evaluation, have a clear understanding of how well we did or what areas would require some improvement in terms of the program that we submitted. This is just a quick overview of what our initial timeline looked like, and I simply split it up into four quarters and then divided the activities into those four quarters. And our first quarter, we actually lost 3 months because it took us almost 3 months to hire staff on. And so we were a bit behind the eight ball to begin with. And of course, the timeline had to be re-evaluated and restructured. But this is the initial timeline. Then we had to work on getting individual organizations to commit to the process. Now that was a really tough one because organizations, these long-term care facilities, home health care agencies, they're very short on staff. They're very short on funds. And time is money. And it was very challenging to try to get them to commit. We had to get them to get their leadership to commit to the process and to understand how important emergency management was. We also tried to get them to sign on to a charter that had been developed and basically was an intent to participate form. And they would sign into this with a clear understanding of what the obligations were, the responsibilities of the participant, and so on and so forth. And those organizations that elected not to sign that form, then if they had active participation throughout the grant cycle, then we just took that as implied consent. Then we also tried to provide incentive for our group and try to get them to commit to actually completing the tasks that were assigned to them in between planning sessions. And we did this by having a star system. One of the staff came up with an idea to reward them with a star, basically, to indicate that they had completed tasks and to pass this out at each of the planning sessions, and thereby trying to instigate a little competition between organizations. Again, we use the all-hazards approach in developing capacity and capabilities that are critical to preparedness for a wide variety of emergencies or disasters. And basically, these all-hazards fall into natural hazards, technological hazards, which are like fire, hazardous materials events, those type of things, human hazards, like terrorism, hostage taking, domestic violence that bleeds over into workplace violence. Also, hazardous materials, chemical or radiological disasters. Now, many organizations would say, well, we don't have those things. We don't have terrorism necessarily in our organization. Or we don't have any chemicals to be exposed to, or radiation to be exposed to. But that doesn't take into consideration that perhaps if you're on a busy or very close to a busy road, then perhaps the chemicals that are being transported on that road, somebody may have an accident in front of your organization, and therefore you may have inadvertent contamination or exposure to chemicals. So there are a lot of reasons why we still evaluate these hazards, even though there is not huge likelihood that the organization may be exposed to them. And again, back to the emergency management cycle, we use the phases of emergency management cycle, which are these four: mitigation and prevention, preparedness, response, and recovery, which you've already seen once. We also concentrated heavily on the incident command structure. It's very important that any organization that's responding to a disaster and working with other organizations, such as
Maine Emergency Management Agency or the County Emergency Management Agency or the Regional Resource Center that provides coordination and support for healthcare organizations during a disaster response, then we all need to be using the same incident command structure. And we want to use the incident command structure that we decided to use was the nursing home incident command structure. And this is a nationally recognized incident command structure specifically designed for long-term care facilities. It's a standardized method of organizing a response and communicating the information that is necessary with our external and internal partners. It also defines responsibilities and reporting channels within the structure and the organization. The same terminology can be used at each of the different organizations that are using this structure. So if I need to speak to the person in charge of the response at one facility, I know that that's always going to be the incident commander. Whereas if I need the person who is going to be talking with the media at another organization, I know that that is going to be the public information officer. So that standardized terminology is very, very important in how we all communicate with one another and determine who we have to work with to get the best or the optimal response.
As part of the program, we also wanted to ensure that each of the participants had a clear understanding about the organizational structure within the state and the federal government. So we start at the bottom, or tier one, with an individual healthcare asset or an individual organization. And that organization works with healthcare coalitions, such as our 10 regional healthcare coalitions that we developed out of the CCOPER grant. And then those healthcare coalitions report up to each of the regional resource centers or the jurisdictional incident management groups. And then the regional resource centers then report up through what used to be Maine Bureau of Health and is now Maine CDC and Maine Emergency Management Agency. There are also strike teams or agreements between three states. There's Vermont, New Hampshire, and the state of Maine. And they share resources in time of disaster when their resources are overwhelmed within their own states. And then finally, we go on to federal resources that can come into the response arena and assist the organizations or the areas to respond appropriately to a disaster. So it's important that the different organizations that were participating in the grant have a clear understanding of how this all works and fits together. Finally, we wanted to make sure that each organization understood that this wasn't the end. When they completed this program, this wasn't the end. That preparedness is a moving target. It is constant, ongoing, all of the time. And so each time you think you've got it finished, then something happens in the national arena, such as Katrina or the bombings in Boston, where you have to reevaluate your plan and to ensure that it is complete and that you've taken into consideration all the issues that may occur and all of the problems that have already been proven to occur. So when we went back and we did that regional needs assessment, what was the purpose? Well, we wanted to assess the current level of preparedness for each of the individual organizations participating in the grant. And we wanted to identify the gaps in planning. The response rate was actually very, very good. The long-term care facilities, 75% responded. Home health care organizations, 100%. So we got very, very good response. Just to give you a little background in regards to the facility size, almost 75% of the respondents were under 80 beds in their facility, so relatively small organizations. And when you're only 3% in the 160 to 180 beds, so the larger facilities were few and far between. So the bulk of organizations would be those very small organizations with very, very limited resources. Also, their proximity to healthcare or acute care facilities, such as a hospital, was approximately 40 or 45% of those organizations were within 5 miles. But there were some outliers that were very, very long distance from any established acute care facility, and therefore would not have the immediate health care response that they may need to assist them in the event of a disaster. Some summary of the findings for the regional assessment that was done. We saw that even though all of the healthcare organizations, when we're talking about long-term care or home health care or assisted living, they, even though they may look the same, there's still some differences between them. Geographical diversity is one. We had some that were located in very rural areas. As I said, some that were very long distance from another acute care facility. And then in some very urban areas where there were multiple acute care facilities available and many resources there to assist them and support them throughout a disaster. They also had variations in their financial structure from private, nonprofit, and for-profit organizations, and variations in their organizational size, which we've already talked about. And they all had varying levels of preparedness. Some additional findings, there's that less than 65% of the organizations had actually budgeted for emergency management planning and response. And this is a huge issue. If there's no money there to support it, then you never really commit to that project and you really can't accomplish what you need to accomplish. If there is no money to support staffing or travel or time to develop the plan, then the project is just not going to get done. So you have to have leadership commitment and a budget to support the activities. We also find that approximately half of the organizations have reviewed their emergency management plan with local, regional, or state officials, or included and coordinated those same officials in their planning. Now, that's actually not a bad response. We want them to do that. We want to get that up to 100, though, 100%. Also, we found that most organizations' emergency management plans included a very basic evacuation plan, as is required by CMS, but it really focused on the shelter-in-place component rather than the criteria for evacuation and the process for evacuation, and that's something that we've already discussed. Also, their plans did not address triage of casualties or quarantine issues that might arise during a biological event. Now, many organizations said, well, why would we have to triage casualties? Well, if you have an explosion or a fire at your facility, it may be a period of time, especially if you're one of those outlying organizations, before the emergency response agencies can get to you and assist you and respond to the casualties in your care. And so you may have to do a little bit of triage and make some decisions on who is going to be treated first. Also, many organizations did not have memorandum of understanding or MOUs with vendors or other organizations that are going to provide services, equipment, space, and supplies to them. And so we identified that as a major area where we needed to develop MOUs, templates that could be used as the baseline again when organizations consulted with these vendors and organizations to create those agreements between them on how to share resources. We also found that many of the emergency management plans did not include any collaboration or planning with other responding agencies, including the Northeastern Maine Regional Resource Center, which is my organization, the American Red Cross, or hospitals. We in fact found that many long-term care facilities had in their plans strategies or plans to evacuate their patients to an acute care facility and had never consulted with that acute care facility that was responsible for taking their patients. Now, if we have a large-scale disaster that is affecting a large geographic territory, which includes an acute care facility and a long-term care facility, then we may have many, many casualties coming into that acute care facility, and they may not be able to take a long-term care facility patient load and take care of those patients. So alternative care sites must be established. And that was something that was significantly missing in the emergency management plans for these organizations. Evacuation plans for long-term care facilities, we found to be generally they were poorly constructed, very limited in scope. Some of them were as small as 2 pages. And they didn't encompass realistic instructions or plans to complete the evacuation of the facility, again, because they focused primarily on shelter in place, which is actually probably most events, that's what you're going to do, shelter in place. But there is the occasional event where you do have to evacuate your plan. And we don't want a repeat of Katrina, where we decide to shelter in place when we should have been making the decision to evacuate. Also, many long-term care facility emergency management plans didn't address surge capacity or surge capability. Now, surge capacity is the ability to care for large numbers of casualties above and beyond normal census. Surge capability is all about caring for the victims with unusual or highly specialized medical needs in adverse situations. So many organizations would say, again, well, I'm not going to accept patients into my long-term care facility. And our response was, you may have to. If you're a good community partner and we're all trying to survive this disaster, whatever it may be, you may have to take early discharges from an acute care facility so that they can make room for the trauma patients coming in. You may have another long-term care facility that needs to transfer some of their patients out or evacuate their facility, and you may need to take a few of those. So there are occasions when we as long-term care facilities may need to accept patients and have a surge plan in place. Other ideas would be in events such as the pandemic influenza, we may have to use some space in long-term care facilities for palliative care. And I know that some of the states have those plans in place already where their long-term care facilities may be taking in patients that require that end-of-life care. Also, maybe some temporary care for rehab nursing home patients. Again, we have to think about everything. We've historically thought about just getting rid of our patients and moving them out. Now we need to also think about how can we assist the other healthcare organizations in our community to survive this event by having a good surge plan in place. Of course, the surge plan, I do want to make mention, is problematic in that there are licensure and regulatory issues in regards to having over your normal census, but there are some leniencies that or some changes in regulations that occur with a declared emergency that allow you to do things that you're normally not allowed to do. And then after we did all of the assessment or the assessment was completed, then there was a prioritization of needs. And interestingly enough, if you look at these 5 priorities, then you'll realize that they are very closely aligned with the 5 planning gaps that were identified earlier on in the presentation. So for planning gap or prioritization number one or need number one, we have staff training and emergency response procedures. That was the 75% of organizations that did not have this in place, and it has been identified as a primary gap in planning. Also, number 2, evacuation and alternative care site planning. Number 3, exercise planning and conduct. Number 4, development of MOUs. And 5, communication redundancy, specifically attuned to technology. Now, none of these are a surprise because we've talked about them all the way through. These are things that came up during early discussions and our informal assessment as well as the formal assessment later on. Now, what are the challenges and barriers that we experienced during this whole process? Well, one, of course, is a shortened planning time period. And that was very, very challenging to try to compress the entire plan into 12 months versus 3 years. Also, there were financial and staffing restrictions or shortages. Within each of the organizations, it was they had to make a huge commitment in order to attend a 5-hour meeting once a month to work diligently on these topics as well as to complete tasks in between these 5-hour meetings. Also, it was very challenging to incentivize our targeted partners. We had a very large geographically diverse territory from very, very rural areas, and some people, if they came to a centralized location, would have to travel more than 5 hours. We also had regulatory limitations on needed surge response, which were very challenging for our partners to accept making plans that are actually going to challenge some of the regulations that they have face on a day-to-day basis. And part of our issue was to identify those challenges with regulatory limitations and to provide a list to our congressional partners to hopefully get those worked on in the future. And then meeting the needs of the home health care agencies. Now, if you recall, home health care and hospice were involved. And we realized, or I realized fairly early on, that we really should have been focusing on those organizations as separate entities at a different time. It was very challenging to focus on two sets of plans because they're very different organization types, and we had to have different plans for each type of organization and long-term care facilities and home health. So it was probably not something that I would do again. I'd separate the two. We also had some huge challenges in regards to the participation of public safety and the emergency management agencies. Much of what was under discussion had nothing to do with them, and so they tended to drop off our radar screen and did not participate in a lot of the planning sessions. Some were very faithful and came consistently, others not so much. So we recognize that we need to have them more as ad hoc members and ensure that the agenda outlines specifically the topics that we need their expertise and consultation on, and allow them to leave when those agenda items have been thoroughly discussed. We found that there was a lack of leadership commitment and buy-in, and primarily because they had no understanding of the value added by their personnel participating in the program. And so that's something that we really had to find a solution for. So what were our strategies for success in incentivizing our participants to come to the planning table with us? Well, basically, we had to pull out the carrot and the stick on these. So the positive incentives, or the carrot, was to identify the value added. And there were value added for finances, as well as being properly prepared. There were morally and marketing values that could be applied to their participation in the program. We had to ensure that there was a limited time commitment for unproductive activities such as travel. So ensuring that each organization did not have to travel more than 50 miles to the meeting place. Less than an hour travel was very important. They were willing to travel that 1 hour, but no more. So we needed to keep their travel time down. Providing a completed product at the finish line, meaning the templates, needed to be provided. They needed to be working on them so that they had a completed disaster plan at the end of the project period. Also, diminishing and limiting the staff obligations, and that came through, again, providing the templates rather than having them develop their own plan from scratch and just educating them about emergency preparedness. We actually developed the templates that they could work from and very easily fill in the blanks to get their foundation documents. And then as time went on, they could improve those and make them more personalized for their organization. Now to the stick. What are our potential negative ramifications of non-participation? And we helped identify the legal and regulatory consequences of failure to prepare or not complying with duty to plan. And those were two of the primary issues that an organization can face in the event that they experience a disaster and have not properly prepared, then they can have civil litigation against them for failure to prepare, which can be upwards of $25 million per charge. So that's a really hefty fine, and it would be very difficult for any organization to survive that kind of fine. So again, financial value added, giving them the carrot. They get free emergency plan management plan templates. They get free consultation. They get free training. And they get free assistance with their HVA, or hazard vulnerability template, and assistance in completing that document. Conservation value of staffing value added. They get networking with the people that they're going to be requesting assistance from in a disaster. And this is very, very important, that we know the partners that we're planning with as well as responding with. It's much easier for me to say yes or to assist someone if I know them personally and I've worked with them already and I know what their capabilities are. Also collaborating with our response partners in the actual planning. So if we expect an acute care facility to assist a long-term care facility, then that collaboration has already occurred and that plan is mutual versus one-sided. The limitation of traveling, we've talked about that already, making sure that each organization had to travel no more than 1 hour. And then the high-intensity monthly meetings. We didn't want to have multiple two-hour meetings where you just get started and then you end. We had five-hour meetings on a monthly basis. They really were very intense, and forward momentum was very hard and pushing, but that also helped conserve their staffing. They could get the assistance there that they needed to improve their plans. Back to the networking. Susan Collins is credited with saying, the middle of a disaster is not the time to exchange business cards. We need to do that ahead of time during the planning process so that in a disaster, I know who to call. I know who to speak to. I know who is going to get me the resources I need to optimize my organization's outcome from that disaster. This is, again, the minimization of travel, the 50 miles. And as you can see on this map, it's a little hard to see, but the blue dots are the different partners that were participating in the program. And then the red stars are the location of the trainings or the planning sessions. And again, we actually measured out 50 miles in each direction and made circles on the map to ensure that we had it covered and that nobody had to travel more than 1 hour. We also made it so that everyone knew when the planning sessions were going to occur. So if they missed it in their own region due to a problem with staffing or scheduling, then they could go to another sub-region to get that same information. And this is just an example of the different regions, the towns that were included in each of the regions, and then the schedule that we used to have the sessions. Meetings were, as I said, high-intensity monthly meetings, 5 hours. We'd provide work within the response group. And once the template was provided and the associated training that would support the completion of that template. So we didn't expect anyone to have a great deal of information or knowledge base regarding alternative care sites. What we did is we would provide them with the information and education, the background about alternative care sites. Then we would provide them with the template so that they then could complete the template for their organization in between meetings. Now the stick, again, the negative ramifications that they would have to face in the event of not planning or the failure to plan, prepare. They, one, would be a lack of compliance with legal and regulatory requirements. Two, the civil litigations that we've already talked about and the associated fines. And three, they have the moral obligation about trying to decrease mortality and morbidity in their patient population as a result of responding to a disaster. And we do know that, particularly in evacuation situations, we see increased mortality and morbidity as much as 3 times normal when we're evacuating our patients to another facility if we don't have that process down and very practiced and well planned, then we can see that increase in mortality and morbidity, and we want to avoid that. Some of the legal and regulatory compliance issues fall under the different categories that we see here. We have Medicare and Medicaid, the Stafford Act of 1988, which supports the and empowers the president to issue regulations to govern the provision of federal assistance for a major disaster. And it also mandates that we protect the general public and vulnerable populations, which all of our nursing home patients fall under. And if we're not providing that assistance and that protection, then we're in violation of the Stafford Act. Pandemic All Hazards Preparedness Act specifically speaks to at-risk individuals, and again, that applies to our long-term care facilities. Older Americans Act, and this you all know about this one. It's a new chapter since in 1992, and it protects the vulnerable populations, elder populations, from abuse, neglect, and exploitation. And this applies in regards to alternative care sites if we put our elder population or our long-term care facility patients in an alternative care site or a shelter where other individuals are also housed, they may be exploited or abused or neglected in that atmosphere. And so we have to plan carefully about where we put that population and do we combine it with general population, which is usually we want to make some provisions to ensure that they are more in a more controlled atmosphere and we can better protect them. The Social Security Act and that requires and it supports basically Medicare and Medicaid Act, and it requires that we have detailed written plans and procedures. Now, many of these acts and laws don't have a great deal of structure to them. They're not detailed. And therefore, you have some flexibility in terms of how much effort you put into your plans. But the problem is that flexibility and that lack of or that vagueness within the act can also, or the law can also work against you in that they may have expectations and interpret it differently in a court of law than you interpret it on face value. And then tort claims, we've already talked a little bit about negligence in regards to nursing homes in Katrina, for instance, where there were some long-term care facilities that elected to shelter in place instead of evacuate, and they unfortunately were unable to evacuate even if they wanted to. We don't want our long-term care facilities in any state to ever be the one that has the nurses on the television saying, as we saw with Katrina, I kissed my patient and hugged them goodbye and had to walk out the door because the water was rising. We don't want to have our employees, our staff members, having to say that. We can't have another repetition of Katrina. We have to better plan how we respond to disasters. Other negative outcomes that may be seen in real-world responses that, again, we don't want to have happen to us. other recent large-scale disasters, and Katrina really was one of these landmark events that showed us so many gaps in our planning for acute care facilities as well as long-term care facilities. We found that transportation contracts weren't honored, so we have to have multiple contingencies for those. We have to reevaluate them annually to ensure that the vendor that we're contracting with continues to have the resources to provide those equipment, supplies, or resources that we need in a disaster. Also, we need to always make sure that we take into consideration the complicated medication needs of our patient population. And if we have to evacuate our patients or those resources cannot be delivered to the organization due to road debris or damage to the manufacturing facility, whatever the case may be, we need to make sure that we have alternatives in place. We need to ensure that our patients continue to get the medication that they need. Host facilities, we found, were unavailable or inadequately prepared. In Katrina, an organization, a long-term care facility, had perhaps an agreement with another long-term care facility that may be 20 miles away. Unfortunately, in Katrina, that organization that was 20 miles away was also affected and could not accept their patients. So patients were evacuated and extended for an extended period of time in other states even. And so we need to make sure that we have adequate plans in place and that if we are an area such as Alabama, Mississippi, and Louisiana, then we want to make sure that we have plans in place where we not only have organizations close by that can accept our patients, but make agreements with organizations outside the state and in other areas that you may be able to transport your patients to. Host facilities were inadequate staffing, insufficient water and food supplies. We need to make sure that our planning is up to date on those as well. Difficult reentry to facilities. Now, this comes under or falls under recovery, getting back to business as normal. And this is very challenging because if you have structural damage to the facility, your patients are reassigned to other locations, what's the likelihood that you're going to get those populations back into your facility? There are marketing issues that are associated with this as well. Increased mortality and morbidity among residents in evacuation situations, which we've already discussed a bit. And then again, failure to prepare. Multiple acute care and long-term care organizations had criminal and civil charges pressed against them following Katrina. And this is the first time that we saw this term of failure to prepare. And we can most likely expect for it to pop up again in other disasters. And we're going to be held liable for not adhering to our duty to plan. And if it is conceivable, as well as it's already occurred, so now it is believable, such as Katrina, then we are obligated to prepare for that eventuality or that hazard. And if we have not done that, then we have failed in to prepare, and we may be liable for that down the road. And then finally, leadership support is an absolute must. The staff members of a long-term care facility will not be able to accomplish their goals and objectives if there is no leadership support. Success is not in their stars, so to speak, if we do not have leadership support. So leadership must be aware of legal and moral consequences of not preparing, and then it must make a commitment, a financial commitment, as well as a personal commitment to support emergency response planning and training efforts within their organization. Now, after all of that incentivizing our partners and getting them on board, one of the other things that we used as a carrot, so to speak, was purchases. And if the organization participated regularly and signed the charter, then they would be eligible to receive an EOC Emergency Operations Center kit. Now, these are the things that were included. There were ICS or Incident Command System structure, quick guides, and they included ICS structure, workplace violence, and public health emergencies. There were weather alert radios and also an emergency crank radio. There's a ham radio that they could use. Hopefully, each organization would have someone trained if they already didn't have someone that was licensed to use a ham radio, and the manual to have that assist them with that training. Yellow medical bracelets, which they could use to identify their patients during an evacuation. Incident command vests and a scanner. When we're talking about scanner, we're talking about a radio scanner. And flashlights and a tote to put everything in and store it. And then we come to program evaluation. We wanted to focus on organizational mitigation and preparedness, including what is the status of their written plans at the end of the grant or program period. What are the status of their MOUs? How many have they completed by the time the program ended? What's the degree of integration of that organization with the traditional emergency response organizations? How well have we encouraged the networking and getting them instilled in that response community? And then how satisfied were they with the overall program and the products that were developed during the program? These graphs just show a little bit of the information that we received back from the final evaluation, and it basically covers how well they like the tools and the resources. The teal color is yes, they liked it. The yellow is no, they didn't. You'll see the one long yellow bar, which is has the knowledge gained been used in any real emergencies faced by your organization. That's why that's no. For the most part, they felt that it was useful information that they would be using a communication the communication products that were purchased. That they felt that the training was useful, and they overall view of the program and the tools was a positive. This is the relevancy and the value of the subject matter in regards to the HVA or the incident command system, communications, evacuation, alternative care sites, notification, mobilization, utilities, safety, and surge, which were all thrown into one category, resource management, staff support, and then continuity of operations plan. And the blue is strongly agree, and the red is somewhat agree. And you can see a little bit of green there with somewhat disagree as well. But for the most part, there was an overwhelming response of strongly agree. And then the final evaluation, how would you rank the overall quality of the project, which was overwhelmingly very good. And then how would you rate the quality of the templates and the other resources that were provided? And that was a wash in regards to excellent or very good. So a very, very good response from our partners. So what are our lessons learned? Well, I've already talked to you about one of the lessons learned, which is I probably would next time separate the home health care and long-term care facilities in terms of the planning. Also, we would require, we noticed even now today, I get requests for ongoing support and assistance with the long-term care facilities and home health care agencies in regards to the implementation of some of the tools that they acquired throughout the CCOPER grant. Not everyone had the opportunity or the time to implement those tools, and they're still asking for support in those areas. So we would have to make a contingency plan for that. Also, I think I would prepare better justification to attain, to encourage the long-term care facilities and assisted living facilities in the goal to integrate with the broader regional healthcare coalition. Now that means right now, after the CCOPER grant, many organizations went back to their normal programs and processes and elected not to join the healthcare coalition. And that's something we really need to work on to get them back to the table and continue their participation in emergency planning and response. And then organizations whose executive leadership viewed emergency preparedness as a priority, we noted that they accomplished far more for those organizations and were more fully engaged in the emergency preparedness process. And so in future grants, I would strongly urge healthcare leadership within those facilities that are targeted to be as supportive as possible and dedicate those time, effort, and resources to the program, and that's the only way we're going to achieve ultimately great success in the program. And now we're open for questions.
Greetings, everyone. We now have our live Q&A session. Again, as usual, please use the chat feature to send in your questions, and after our Q&A, we would like to ask each of you to participate by answering the short evaluation questionnaire. Also, please mute your microphones for the benefit of our speakers and the other folks on the conference. Thank you. All righty. We do have a question, and the first question, did the CCOPER program have any provisions for culturally or linguistically diverse seniors in the emergency planning? Okay, and I'm going to turn that over.
Okay. This is Kathy Knight. I'll respond to that. In regards to the location where the CCOPER grant was used, it was in 9 counties with very little diversity, approximately 90%, 5% of the population speaks English. Even the northern regions that are close to the Canadian border and some of the Canadian elderly might be in some of our nursing homes up there. They may be French speaking. They still also are dual language and spoke English as well. So we don't have in this region a highly diverse population. And so, no, we did not address that. One of the other questions that has been asked is, what agency is responsible for finding beds for long-term care residents during an emergency? In the state of Maine, we are developing or have developed a process by which we would have on the local level the hospital or the long-term care facility would make arrangements during their planning, emergency planning. We would hope that they would make arrangements with other healthcare organizations to accept their patients and would work with them on a local level. If the need was beyond, or the demand for beds was beyond what they could handle, then they would bring that problem to the Northeastern Maine Regional Resource Center or one of the other regional resource centers. And then we would work with Maine CDC, the Maine Healthcare Association, all three regional resource centers, as well as the local long-term care facilities to work out a strategic plan on how we could distribute that patient population. We are developing in our half-bed system, and now the half-bed system is a system that documents the bed availability for hospitals primarily in the state of Maine. And we are adjusting that program and adding criteria for beds for long-term care facilities in the near future. And this will provide us with an opportunity, or a long-term care facility, an opportunity to look at what's available for beds on the application and be able to assist them in distributing their patient population. But if in a disaster, obviously this is going to be an overwhelming situation for any long-term care facility, and they would just give us a call and we would help coordinate and support their efforts. all disasters are managed locally, so they would be managing their own response, but we would provide the coordination support necessary to get the best outcome. Another question that was put forward is, are presenters aware of templates for CMS pre-approval of space for surge to long-term care facilities during an emergency? An example, pre-approval to expand number of beds or to use dining room common spaces for additional long-term care residents or displaced community elders. This is a great question, and this is also a question that I hear very frequently. And there are very strict regulations that guide the long-term care facility and their utilization of their space and their beds. Obviously, you know that better than I do. In any disaster situation, there are some events that will provide, as I mentioned in the presentation, some leniency or some latitude in your operations. If there is an emergency declaration in the state or in the country, then that softens some of the may soften some of the regulations. What long-term care facilities in each state have to do is they have to work with their state government to get pre-written waivers during a disaster or emergency situation that can be put out there in the event that a disaster occurs and you need to be able to take in additional patients and, or to use your austere environment such as your conference space to put residents into those locations. That requires you working with, in our state, it would be the Maine Healthcare Association. We've been trying to work a little with them and Maine CDC and the Attorney General in the state, trying to come up with a way to, or a waiver that can be used and signed off by the governor in the event of a disaster as part of his emergency declaration, which again gives you that latitude. This is a constant ongoing problem and something that each state has to work on individually. What is the process in Maine for matching level of care and male/female beds when moving from one long-term care facility to another in emergency? I will probably guarantee you that in a real disaster, when you're mostly just concerned about the safety and welfare of your patient population. So male beds or female beds are not going to be high on your priority list. You're primarily interested in just getting them to a safe location where they can be cared for on a temporary basis until such time as you can manage to put them into appropriate male-female beds and the whole nine yards. But if they're going to an austere environment such as a shelter, it's just an open area. If they go into perhaps another long-term care facility, they may not have male-female beds. They may even be in hallways or conference spaces. So that can be very challenging. And as I said, you're primarily concerned about their safety and welfare, and then you'll move on later to work with those other agencies such as in our state, the regional resource centers and Maine CDC to find the appropriate distribution of those patients to the other long-term care facilities or healthcare organizations. What agency is responsible for finding beds for long-term care residents during an emergency? And that was one of the questions that I had just answered a moment ago. We would use the HABBED system. Once that's finished being developed for the long-term care facilities, we'll use that as a mechanism to identify available beds. The long-term care facility that would be evacuating would be utilizing our services as well as Maine CDC and Maine Healthcare Association to again, distribute their patients within their communities. But it's very important that they already have their original plan in place. They have those MOUs, a memorandum of understanding with other healthcare organizations that may be willing to take their patients. Those should be the foundation of their plan. And then if that they are unable to meet their obligations in the MOUs during the disaster, then they would call upon us.
I think in the spirit of time, Kathy probably should review the emergency preparedness checklist and come back to any questions at the very end of the Q&A if there's time.
The tool that has been provided is the emergency preparedness checklist, and this is for healthcare facility planning. It is been developed by the Centers for Medicare and Medicaid Services, and it's a very good baseline planning tool to do a little self-survey to find out if you have accomplished any of these goals and objectives on the tool. It asks you about have you developed an all hazards hazard vulnerability analysis. Have you identified who your partners are and networked with them? And this is very important that you network prior to a disaster rather than wait for the disaster to occur before you meet the people that you will be depending on. Have you developed your emergency operations plan and identified your valuable vendors and partners that you need to develop MOUs with? What does your communication plan look like? And have you made decided criteria that are going to make the difference in your planning and your execution of your plan as to whether you shelter in place or you evacuate your facility. What staff training do you have in place, and have you prepared your residents and their family members? And then finally, exercises and drills. Are you participating in exercises in your community and testing the plan that you have and making revisions in an ongoing fashion? When you're grading, you would grade it as not, your plan is not started in terms of the component that has been identified. It's in progress or it's been completed. Many folks say that they have a plan in place, but it's actually in someone's head and it's not on paper. That's not a completed plan, by the way. You might get away with in progress, but it is not a completed plan. So until it's on paper, it's approved, and you're testing that. So the tool is available. It's a good starter tool. It's something for you to begin with. You can use this on an annual, ongoing fashion. Also, if you're a Joint Commission certified facility, then Joint Commission standards are obviously something that you have to evaluate on an annual basis as well. But this is, as I said, this is kind of a starter tool. I think that as you move past and you get these components of your plan in place, then you would want to start looking at a more detailed planning tool. Are there any questions in regards to the tool? Okay. So the next question would be, how do long-term care facilities communicate their facility status during an emergency, and to what agencies? Again, the long-term care facilities in my region would report to me, as well as the county or local EMAs. So the splitting of the duties is we do medical, behavioral, and public health emergency preparedness and response. So, and that's out of the regional resource center. So if they have any medical needs or behavioral health or public health needs, then they would bring those to us. If they have a need for debris removal or water, food, those type of issues, then they would go to the local and the county emergency management agency. And so they're dealing with two different groups, and we collaborate together to make sure that their needs are met. So a final question would be, what agency takes the lead in Maine in arranging for transportation for long-term care residents to evacuate during an emergency? This will be primarily the individual organization would have memorandum of understanding in place with organizations or vendors that would assist them in the transportation of their patients during an evacuation. In addition to that, again, they would go through our organization and Maine CDC, and we would assist them.
Excellent. Well, thank you very much. We're running out of time here for our Q&A. Dear audience, thank you for your participation in this this last webinar of the series. If you enjoyed this presentation, please be aware that completion of the survey you should see on your screen will help Stanford GEC to continue to obtain funding for important educational programs. We also invite you to visit our website at sgec.stanford.edu to explore other resources in ethnogeriatrics. This is Nate Gardner, and this concludes our webinar for today.